out there, How to Drink fans, we're here in the after party world, and I'm Dr. Teeth.
Okay, Dr. Teeth. It's kind of an old Western vibe as well.
Yeah, sure. I can only do that guy's voice when I'm pretty drunk. And I'm pretty drunk today on After Party. Should we pull a card or should we just dive in on another question?
Pull a card, see what happens.
Let's pull a card. Let's pull a question card.
Light.
When you sit next to someone on a plane, what do you think goes through their mind? Oh, that's fun. That one I don't mind. That's a good one. God, do you want to take this one first, Meredith, or do you want me to take this one first? I'm making myself a saffron soda.
Well, so I speak sometimes, not all the time, to people sitting next to me on a plane, so I think I get a pretty good idea what's in their mind.
Oh, fair enough. But pretend you're not speaking to them.
Sure, someone I am not speaking to.
You're not on speaking terms. While you think about this, Meredith, I just want to explain, because I realize that people may not know. Just did an episode before we filmed this, and this is like the third after party after that episode, by the way, where we made a bunch of very fancy syrups. And this one has got saffron in it. And I'm just playing around with it. I'm going to make myself a soft drink with saffron soda. You're sitting next to a passenger on an airplane. You know what I always think of?
I have some assumptions what you think, but go ahead.
Fight Club?
Oh, Fight Club.
Yeah. Because he's got that whole like single serving friend thing.
Yeah, right. So you think they're thinking you're a single serving friend?
No, I just, the question itself makes me think of that. Mm-hmm. Which of course makes me think of Midnight Local. Our podcast where we mostly talk about movies, but also anything we want.
We talk about
movies over there. You're on Midnight Local, the podcast from How to Drink, where we just talk about things.
Movies.
Pop culture.
Maybe some video games.
That too. All the things.
Things. The stuff and things.
All of the stuff and the things on Midnight Local.
Let's get to it.
And Fight Club, I guess Fight Club's going to have to be one of them at some point.
I think so.
No, I just, it's come up a few times because, like, I think Fight Club is one of those movies that is so broadly misunderstood by the people who watched it and who fell in love with it. Me, my high school bros. Actually, I got to say, I was not that into it. I've brought this up a few times, but, like, there was a group of guys I was hanging out with for a minute who, like, wanted to watch Fight Club every friggin' week, and after once, I was like, that's enough. You know? It's like, I don't know that I need to see that again right now.
They're just like, again, brothers, we watch.
We watch, yeah, they wanted to watch that and American History X, like, back to back on a loop. And I'm not gonna lie, they were getting the wrong messages from both. I got out of there. Here we go, one saffron soda. Anyway, back to the question at large. People on a plane. What are they thinking about you when they sit next to you?
About me. I usually think that people are
so cool.
Thinking
super cool
about not wanting to be delayed. I just think people are thinking about where they're going. Where they're going next.
You just assume that everybody has like very mundane, like, oh God, air travel.
I mean, you're stuck on a plane. I think, like, how are you gonna entertain yourself? Where are you going? I think less about what people are thinking and more about where they're going. Or I try to assume good with the bitters.
Oh, it's okay.
I try to figure out, like, do they live where they're flying from or where they're flying to?
So you try to figure out, but what do you think they're thinking about? Inquiring minds want to know, Meredith. I'm just going to let everybody know that, one, I'm a little bit drunk from filming a bunch of these back to back, and so I'm having a soft drink in this little after party. I think Meredith's got some booze in her glass.
I do have. I like the Weller, the green Weller.
Oh, she just went for a glass of whiskey.
Yeah.
And we're taking turns having drinks and soft drinks. And this one is a saffron soda that I made with like some lime and saffron syrup and then a couple dashes of Ango and seltzer. And let me tell you what, you should be able to buy this in a store. This is very good. It's so floral. It's delicious. It's unbelievable. You want to try it?
Sure.
Give it a sip.
Give the saffron another.
Yeah,
try.
Give the saffron. Meredith has not been real into the saffron. She says she can't really taste it, which is like.
Dare I get something other than just sweet?
Okay.
Okay. I think I know what the flavor is now. I think I've had enough of it. It is not a punch you in the face flavor, though.
No, it's not, but it is a flavor that people like fought genocidal wars to control.
Yeah, that I can't understand.
I think it's pretty close to like the real world. Well, no, that would be oil, but like the spice.
Really?
from
lots of spices on my list of things to fight for before saffron.
Oh, what's your, forget the cards. What's your spice you're going to die for?
I'm going to die for basil.
Well, that's an herb, first
off.
Oh,
okay. All right.
Spice. But I'll allow it. There is one correct answer.
What spice would I die for? There's one correct answer.
There is, biologically.
Salt?
Yeah. You need it to live.
Yeah.
You need it to live.
Absolutely.
But we'll rule salt out. Let's just pretend it's an aesthetic question.
I'm trying to think what I use the most.
Cumin for me. I love cumin.
Like cinnamon, maybe?
Oh, cinnamon. Yeah. I like cinnamon, too. Mrs. How to Drink hates anything with cinnamon, and
really
so I don't get to use it much.
Person so much, but yeah.
So, back to the question at large. Person next to you on a plane, what are they thinking about? They're thinking about their destination. That's what you figure.
Or, like, I hope this person doesn't have to get up and go to the bathroom. I think, like, most people are really gripey when they travel, so it's just like, oh, my bags, oh, my this, oh, that. I don't think, like, it's not a time that I ever, like, mid-flight, maybe I get deep into thought. Mid-flight, things change.
All right, so what I think the person next to me is thinking is a whole lot of thoughts I have about the person next to me. First off, I'm on a plane. Whoa, that's crazy, because I'm probably not on a plane. I don't really fly. I don't fly. I mean, I have flown several times since the accident. But at the moment, I'm in a non-flying way.
it's been a long time, right?
Last time I flew was before daughter number one was born. Flew down to Florida, but drove back. Couldn't get back on the plane.
Okay.
And then before that, we flew to the UK. And then before that, the last time I was on a plane is when I was jumping out of it. But yes. Oh no, that's not true. I flew to Florida twice before the UK because I had like work down there where I had to go down for 24 hours and come back. I forgot about those two gigs. One time I went alone, which made me feel very mature and like a guy who was in control of himself and not afraid to fly. Only once did I pull that one off.
But were you okay flying before?
Yeah.
But you didn't do a lot of it, probably.
I flew a lot.
You did?
Yeah, reasonably so.
Okay.
Went to Hawaii, went to Germany, went to Florida, went to Jamaica. I mean, I flew. I flew to get to Georgia.
But like as soon as I graduated high school, I was flying like every other month.
Every other month?
Yeah, because I moved. I went to Florida.
Oh. And you had to go home.
And then went to New York. Yeah, and I'd go home or I'd visit friends or...
Huh. How nice for you.
JetBlue had $49 flight from Orlando to Chicago. It's great.
I flew many times in high school and before, or not a few times in high school and a few times before, but like, yeah, I flew. I flew a bunch of times. Actually, I flew on a DC-10 to Germany, which apparently is like one of the most fatal planes ever to fly the skies. Killed a lot of people, apparently. It's a bad plane. Anyway, so what am I thinking? Well, the first thing I'm going to assume is that they, like me, have resigned themselves to die on this flight. That the only way
I thought you were going
to go. Yeah, certainly they have assumed that this plane will not reach its destination, and they are trying to make their peace with that, because that is the only way I get onto an airplane since the accident. The event. This is awful. But the next thing I'm thinking is, I wonder if... do these people recognize me? That's the next horrible thought in my head. Oh, God. Also, this is an entirely imaginary situation because I would never be sitting next to a stranger on a plane. I would be sitting next to my wife because the idea that, like, I would let an airline sit me wherever it wanted to. Forget about getting on a plane. Like, I'm going to be... let them seat me next to a stranger and burden that stranger with my, like... insane panic anxiety. No, not gonna happen. We're gonna pay the extra bucks to sit next to each other.
I've had a couple flights with someone who was panicking next to me, and I've spent a good portion of that flight trying to not make it worse. Or like they just want to talk, they need to talk all the way through the flight, and trying to like figure out things to talk about.
That would probably help me. I also need a window seat. I can't not have the window.
Oh, you like the window, not the aisle.
I want as much information as possible.
Yeah, I'm the same way. I like to see.
I need to see out the window when I would fly, and I need to watch the map thing. Mm-hmm. And I remember on some planes it shows you like airspeed and ground speed and stuff like that, you know. And I'd be watching that, and I'd be like, oh, those numbers are low. I don't like those numbers, you know. Yeah. And like, but seeing like good numbers there made me feel very good.
Sure. I guess if you ever do watch Yellow Jackets, which I don't imagine you will, skip the first episode.
I'm not afraid of seeing plane crashes. It doesn't affect me. Doesn't make it worse. No. No, not at all. Seeing media representations, that stuff doesn't freak me out.
Yeah. Don't watch the Boeing documentary.
Seeing a visceral, and well-presented parachute entanglement might cause me to have some flashbacks. but that's pretty specific. I haven't seen a lot of that in movies.
Yeah, less and less I want to fly. Like, if I can drive, we're probably driving.
I did see, like, an article the other day that just said, like, record number of near misses in commercial airline industry. And I was like, oh, shit.
Well, and that's something that's, now that I know that, like, money is more important to people than other things, they can
fucking
recover
Max,
from
dude.
Certain problems.
Holy
like,
shit.
I struggle. Like, that Boeing documentary really
was it about the 737 MAX?
Yeah.
That pisses me off to a degree that is, like, hard to put into words.
Yeah.
Holy shit, that pisses me off. Yeah, monstrous shit.
Well, and it's like, oh, there's forces at control here besides people just wanting to be the best and perfect at their job. And I don't like that. I don't like knowing that. So, yeah.
They're value engineering that shit.
Like, I will travel, and if traveling equals flying, I can do it. But like, we drive to Chicago now. We've driven to Texas a bunch of times.
Texas is a long drive.
It's long, but
how many days does that take you? One night or two?
It's 27 hours.
So
I think.
You do two nights or one night?
We've done it in two nights.
Want to do another question?
Yeah, sure. Let's do. I want to know what movies you would. I do. I want to know what movies or shows you would take with you. If you could only, let's say, three or five.
Opening it up to shows actually does change things. Well, three or five, specify.
It wouldn't be entire shows. You could pick, like, an episode.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Okay, well, that's out then. Forget shows. If I could take, like, all of a show, that does change things.
Of course it changes things, because you have more entertainment.
Yeah, yeah.
Desert Island.
Desert
stuck.
Island.
You open up a suitcase.
Okay.
What three?
Three pieces of media.
Do you want to see there? This feels like a Midnight Local question.
Yeah, Midnight Local move here. What three pieces of media do I bring with me to the desert island? They're in my salvage suitcase to salve the point that I may be here forever. Mm-hmm. Well, Castaway is not one of them. irony be damned, but no, I just don't like that movie very much. So my favorite movie is Sunset Boulevard. I'm just going to pick that right off the top. I'm going to go with Sunset Boulevard. I love that movie. It is... It's one of the few pieces of content I actually rewatch.
Because you don't rewatch a whole lot.
Not a lot. I don't watch that one, like, on a regular basis, but I do rewatch that one. You've seen Sunset Boulevard,
right?
Oh,
yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Love it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic.
Great movie.
Yeah. It was crazy, because the first time I encountered it, I was just, like, flipping around, and I caught it. And I didn't catch the first shot, but it was pretty early on. And he was fleeing from repo men. And I was like, I'm a repo man. Wait a minute, what's this about?
This resonates with me.
Yeah, exactly. The next one, should we go one for one? Should you pick now?
Sure, we can go one for
one. All right, you go now and then I'll go.
So I'd have to go with Fried Green Tomatoes.
Ooh, yep.
Which I always say is my favorite. But the reason it's my favorite is because it's got the magical combination of I could watch it over and over and over again. And it's a well-made movie.
Good combo.
Yeah.
Powerful
combo.
It
entertains me, and it's a well-made movie.
This might be a sidebar. Was that your awakening?
I was watching that movie when I was so young. I very, very, very much identified with Iggy Threadgood.
Iggy
is the blonde girl.
Oh.
Not Mary Louise Parker's. The other girl.
I saw that movie when I was 11 or so, and I don't remember the cast.
So first of all, this movie has a lot going on. There's a lot of movies within the movie.
A little cannibalism going on, too.
A little bit. They do feed.
Slight case of cannibalism.
Slight. Unknown, unwitting cannibalism.
Cannibalism all the same.
But no, she comes down the stairs, and they're trying to get her a dress for her sister's wedding. And her knees are all cut up and her hair's everywhere. And I just loved her. She was who I identified with.
Gotcha. All right.
And then I didn't even know that there was any sort of underlying.
Yeah. I don't think I did either as a kid.
Right. In the movie, like, in the book, it's much more spelled out
right
for you. In the book or in the movie, it's like there's a couple of lines and then they're relying on people either knowing the book or not knowing the book.
I think that basically though the coding about that was like there's two ladies who are lifelong friends. They're right. Ladies and they're friends.
Well, and she tells her at one point, like, when she's got a kid and her life is much more complicated than Iggy's, and she tells Iggy, like, you should go, you should find yourself a husband, you should, I'll be fine. And she tells her, like, I'm as settled down as I ever want to be. That's, like, as close as they get to just saying it flat out in the movie.
It's funny because you say that that's as close as they get to saying it flat out, but I have no fucking clue how that could be saying it at all.
She's saying, I want to live with you. Like, I'm going to stay and help you raise your kid and
okay.
Live with you.
I didn't hear that.
Oh, yeah.
I heard, like, I'm a wild woman. You can't stop me.
Oh, no, that's not at that point in their lives. They've opened up a store together. They're, like, they're
got
living
it.
Together.
Got it.
Like,
got it.
No, that's not okay. The undertone at all.
Okay. Yeah, my mom liked that. Well, I don't know if she liked that one, but she really liked the two ladies who drive off the cliff.
Oh, Thelma and Louise.
Thelma and Louise did not realize that was a gay movie.
It's not. I mean, it doesn't have to be.
I agree with that. I mean,
I don't think there were a lot of movies with two female lead characters.
It's got plausible deniability, if you prefer.
But there's never much inference that the two of them have any interest in each other.
No, but I do think that there was like an
I just don't like men
idea of that time frame that like portrayals of lesbians, they're not sexual creatures. They're asexual creatures.
Yeah, I think unless that's a getting miss into for like, that movie.
Unless you're getting into like erotic cinema, really daring cinema.
I think that men confuse women who are fed up with men as lesbianism.
I think you should take it up with the director because I'm pretty sure I've heard him in interviews say that.
Well, probably shouldn't be a male director in that movie to begin with.
Ridley Scott made some great movies.
Like, the one of the women has been raped. The other one, like, almost gets, or does get, no, almost. She gets saved by her friend. Like, they're just done with childish men in their lives. Mm. Like, and it's either go back to being a housewife or drive off a cliff. Driving off a cliff.
Yeah, drive off a cliff. Let's
but
just
I don't
keep
think
on
it has
going.
Anything to do with them being gay at all.
Well, yeah, in that movie, do you think that they, when the one said, why don't we just keep on going?
Yeah.
Do you think the other one knew what she was talking about? Or is she like, wait, no!
They grab hands.
Not
so yes.
What I meant! We could have made a turn!
Yeah, right. I do love that movie. Early young Brad Pitt.
Yeah, that was my mom's favorite part.
Yeah, of course.
I don't think that I've seen that movie more than once.
Oh, every couple of years that comes into rotation.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Is it surprising that I haven't seen that movie more than once?
No.
Yeah, demo-wise, right? Like.
Yeah, but it's also like, I don't know, I would think in film school you would have seen it, maybe.
No, it didn't come up. We didn't do that one. Yeah, it didn't come up in my classwork. Okay, so my second pick is going to be... I'm going to go... Cause my answer is so pretentious. I'm going to go with Gold Diggers of 1933, which is a pre-code movie that came out in 1933. It's a musical. This is my feel-good pick. It's a Depression-era musical. It's got some wonderful actors and actresses in it. You've got Joan Blondell, my crush. Ruby Keeler kills it in this movie. Ida Lupino's in this movie. And one other lady whose name is escaping me at the moment. Ginger Rogers is in it, right, yeah. Mm. Oh yeah, the quartet, man. They kick ass in this movie. And then a bunch of other people are in it as well. But Ned Sparks, of course, a joy to see in anything as a great character actor. I think Guy Kibbe might make a turn in this one as well. There's a bunch of like Warner Brothers character actors in it and stuff like that. But boy, is it a fun movie. And the best part to me is you've got these insane Busby Berkeley musical numbers, and he's at the peak of his powers here.
Mm-hmm.
Because those pre-code Busbys are something special. Mm-hmm. His budgets kept getting slashed and slashed after that, and like he was kind of off of his game, and he had less and less control and less free reign to do his insane, hallucinogenic friggin' musical numbers with thousands of extras and chorines and stuff, like just over the
swimming pools. Was that multiple movies or like one movie that's just iconic?
No, that's Gold Diggers of 33. That's Footlight Parade, which is another one that's really good. I think Gold Diggers has a better structure. Footlight, I also truly love. They came out within a year of each other. The difference is that Gold Diggers has its musical numbers throughout it.
Okay.
And also deals more directly with Depression era themes. Footlight Parade is a little bit more of a fantasy, but like the way the movie is structured, basically all the musical numbers are back to back in the final act.
Mm.
Because like the whole thing,
like American in Paris, is the whole opera's at the end, right?
Oh, I don't. I've seen that movie maybe once. Yeah. That might be true.
It's like a 30-minute dance ballet sequence at the end of the movie.
So Footlight Parade is about. Is he a movie? No, he does a musical review show. And then he's going out of business because the pictures are taken over. Like, this is Cagney's job. And then they have this idea that, like, well, what about pre-shows to go with movie theaters? We'll put troops of dancers into shows that follow movies around and open the movie theater for them. Because movie theaters were an experience back in the day. Wonderful experience, I guess. And so he's this harried producer who's sending all of these, like, one-act musicals numbers, like, reviews on the road all the time road shows. And they're always rehearsing and rehearsing and rehearsing. And he gets ripped off by his bosses. And in the end, he's got this one opportunity to kind of make a name for himself. He's got to impress Mr. Apollinaris, who owns a chain of movie theaters. He's just like kind of an angry Greek businessman. He's always complaining about his agita, a terrible agita. And so the final act of the movie is where you get the big Busby numbers where they have to do three reviews in one night at three theaters, and they're like racing from theater to theater. And so the three numbers happen back to back to back.
Got it. Okay.
The one that you're thinking of is By a Waterfall, which is the most iconic. It was in the ride Disney World.
Right. In the great movie ride.
The great movie ride. Oh, the great movie ride. How we miss you.
Yes.
That's the number that is memorialized there. He may have done some more water ballets and other stuff, but that's the one.
Mm.
And it's pre-code, so it's saucy.
I can't wait to get to some pre-code stuff on the podcast.
I can't either. I really am looking forward to taking you down pre-code lane on Midnight Local. It's real saucy. Every single shot by a waterfall is about doing it. It's all real sexy. Like, there's a shot in that number where he configures all the ladies into a giant zipper and has them unzip. Like, yeah. There's a lot of, like, also, like, there's some stuff where it's like, well, that's actually explicit, where it's just like, let's look straight up the skirts, boys. I don't know. I kind of, you know, everybody was getting paid. You know what I'm saying?
You know, we have this very, I grew up with a very puritanical view of everything pre-1960s.
Okay.
But one of the things that sort of was like, wait a second, was my which is an incredible thing that we have in our family, but we have video of my grandparents' wedding reception.
Mm.
And my great-grandmother is drunk out of her mind in this video. And just, like, sitting on laps and kissing cheeks. And, like, she was a flapper. She was very, like... And I asked my mom, I was like, wait a second. I was led to believe that my family is very squared. She's like, ooh, she was anything but. She was a party animal.
So the thing of that is... And this is so stupid. I just did a Twitter thread about this.
Mm-hmm.
The greatest generation... The World War II generation, who were 18, 19, 20 years old when World War II rolled around. We'd been beating that war drum for a while.
Yeah.
Basically, to get all of America mobilized, because it was a total war. Every industry was captured by the war effort. We rebuilt the society into a propaganda machine. And if you look at the generation prior, the actual Depression era generation who had survived the Dust Bowl, who these movies made in the pre-code were speaking to, they didn't have those mores, right? Like, they were not raised on that kind of a steady diet of white Christian nationalist propaganda.
Right.
Let's go save democracy, which, you know, admittedly, we were a big part of doing, which is good. We like crushing the Nazis. But yeah, the previous generation, I think, especially if you watch pre-code cinema and you see what they were concerned about, what they were talking about, the representation that exists in those movies, it is, something went backwards here.
Yeah.
And I think that there's a through line there between the Hays Code, which ends what we call pre-code cinema, 1934, and then immediately thereafter you've got one blacklist and then another blacklist, the second bigger blacklist, which I always point this out, created by John Wayne, Ronald Reagan, and Hedded Hopper. I think you took every voice that would have attempted to dissent against that singular vision out of mass media. Just took them out. And all what ended up happening is, like, every movie became Fox News.
Yeah.
For two generations. So that all of the Greatest Generation were raised on that. All of their kids, the boomers, were raised on that. And basically all of their kids were raised on that. And they were raised by people who were raised on that. And that truly redirected the course that America was on. Not overnight, but was like, it was a very rapid shift in culture.
It's brilliant to use movies because it was mass media in a way that no one had experienced before.
It was
the
media.
The internet.
There was no television. Yeah. There was radio and movies.
Right.
Comic books.
Yeah, right.
You know, that was my number two, Gold Diggers of 33.
And I'm going to derail this completely.
No, but I just want to... So I picked Gold Diggers, though, because, like, I actually do rewatch that movie somewhat frequently. I really like that movie. Mm-hmm. It's a good one. It's fun.
It's so very insightful of you. My second movie would be Sister Act 2, Back in the Habit.
Oh, yeah, of course. A classic.
Yeah.
One of the great films.
What a great title. Back in the Habit. So many different meanings.
Yeah, yeah. One of America's... I get it. Well, there's mostly two meanings.
Mostly two.
How many other than two are there?
Well, back, because we're coming back. It's the second movie.
Oh, sure.
We're back in the habit of being a nun and also in the actual...
Wearing a habit.
Habit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But also she's like, she's also going back to her old ways.
Yeah, right. Sort of. Yeah, revisiting her stint as a nun, and actually back in the habit of, like, she does do the same thing she does in the first movie and takes them from, like, a closing, dying entity. In the first movie, she's saving the convent from closing, and the second movie, she's saving the school from closing. She saves both times she saves them with the choir. Fantastic.
It's a power song.
So from childhood, I just, like, memories of watching this movie with my sister and my big cousin and singing the song. So part of it is, like, childhood memories that would come up if I was alone on a desert island. Part of it is, Sister Act 2 specifically was like my high school friends, and we watched, I could probably recite that movie line for line easier than any other movie. And it just happens to be a good movie. It's a
it probably
fun,
is. I'm sure it's good.
Wonderful movie. Lauryn Hill's in it.
Yeah.
Jennifer Love Hewitt's in it.
She is.
Yeah, she's one of the students.
Okay, that's your number two?
Yeah.
We're only through number two. Jesus, this is taking forever. All right, my third desert island pick. I better pick a doozy, right? Something really weird. Return of the Living Dead. I fucking love that movie. I love that movie. Just love it. Oh, but I'm on a desert island. I'm just thinking about this now, and this is gross, but, like, I probably should have picked something with a lot more boobs in it than that one scene if I'm on a desert island for the rest of my life, you know?
Sure, fair enough.
Let's set that aside.
You can draw boobs in the sand.
I can. I can do it very well.
I'm trying to think of, like, what episode of Buffy I would have to bring with me.
But it's only a 30-minute show. You're going to bring
40 minutes. It is an hour long.
I don't know.
It's that or Kill Bill Volume 1.
Oh, interesting.
Which is just a movie that I can watch at, like, on loop for
you like Tarantino?
Whatever reason. Huh?
You like Tarantino?
Generally, no, but I love
Generally, no, but you like that. Okay.
Tarantino is fine for me, but I love that movie.
Gotcha.
I love that movie.
Tarantino, I think to some people online, especially, is what I see. I don't know. It's become kind of synonymous with, like, film bros.
Well, I think that's true, and I think he makes the same movie over and over and over and over again. Like, he likes to make a retaliation movie.
Yeah, that's true. They're all kind of revenge.
Yeah. But that is, that one, the colors, you know, it's very poppy and stimulating.
It's a good flick.
Yeah.
It's a good flick. That came out right around the same time, I think, as Gangs of New York, because I remember seeing both in the theater about the same time.
That makes sense. Yeah. It would have been about 2008 or 9.
If you say so.
I remember because I was in... So I was in Florida for 2 years.
Yeah.
It was a very short window,
yeah.
And so I know exactly what years those were,
yeah.
And I know I saw that movie when I was living in Florida.
There's only one movie I have like that, really. Went to the movie theater when I graduated basic. My friends came down, you get like a couple days off, a weekend or whatever, and we went to the movies because I was like, I haven't been to the movies in like months, let's go to the movies. And we saw the Matthew McConaughey dragon movie. Mm-hmm. You know that one?
No.
Matthew McConaughey fights dragons. Mm-mm. You don't know about that? Yeah, he plays a guy who fights dragons. Christian Bale's in it. Christian Bale and
Look up Matthew McConaughey dragon.
I think it's Reign of Fire. That might be what it's called.
Oh, I remember that movie.
Christian Bale and Matthew McConaughey fight dragons in England. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I misspoke. It was 2003 or 4, because 8 or 9 is when I graduated college.
Yeah, 8 or 9 seemed late.
I went from high school to Florida, so it was 3 or 4.
That sounds more right to me.
That is.
Yeah. That's our 3.
That's it. We kind of went thematically from planes to stuck on the desert island. We could have made a better transition.
Well, I will say that the entrance for Matthew McConaughey in Reign of Fire is that he shows up on like a C-5 cargo plane from America as basically John Wayne with his own private army to fight the dragons. And so, in that respect, airplanes matter quite a bit.
Why not?
Reign of Fire!
You should... But do you enjoy this movie?
I have no idea.
Just remember when it...
I saw it
once. Remember seeing it.
I saw it once in a movie theater, and at the time I was like, this is a great movie. This is fine. You know? I was very uncritical.
I would love to do an episode where we both think two of our, like, favorite non-critically acclaimed movies.
Yeah.
Movies that you just love for whatever
reason. Stupid flicks that you
love. Yeah, like Distracted.
Yeah, sure. I don't know. Other than Return of the Living Dead, which we've already done, I don't know what else I would pick.
Is that not critically acclaimed?
No, not really.
Kind of a cult classic,
I guess. It's a cult classic. That's not the critics. Like, horror critics like it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it has some notoriety with a group of people.
Oh, definitely, definitely. You want, like, obscure movies that nobody knows.
Not obscure. No, that's not what I'm going for. Just, like...
Watch Witch Hunt.
Okay.
Yeah, HBO Films made it in the 90s. Stars Dennis Hopper and Eric Bogdanovich and Penelope Cruz, I think. Not Penelope Cruz. I can't think of her name. It's somebody else. I can't remember her name right now. It's not great, but I love it. Not great might be a slight understatement, actually.
That's exactly what I'm talking about. Not great, but I love it. But not purposefully bad like The Room or Trolls 2.
Certainly not. No, they were trying to make a decent movie there. I mean, I think it was written by, and maybe even directed by, I can't think of his name now, but the guy who wrote Taxi Driver.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Well, that's like Showgirls, which we'll get to.
Do Showgirls. We got to do a whole series on... over on the podcast on Midnight Local, we have to do a whole series on Paul Verhoeven
because
he is a fascinating director. Fascinating director. My God, what a turn his career took. Meredith, I think this was fun. I got to call it a night.
Okay.
This after party is long.
This was a long one.
I'm done.
Yeah.
I want to lie down.
That's fair. We got other things to do.
Got
more days to shoot.
That's dinner time. Good night. Good luck.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Party time over. Oh, is that? We should have a sign out for the party show. Party over. Party out, bruh. I don't know.
The party over lights. Have you ever been at a party where someone's elbow hits the like kitchen light on suddenly?
Yeah.
And everyone's like, oh, why? No. That's the party over moment.
Yeah, it is. I don't know that I've been to many parties that happen in the dark.
It's not dark, not like dark, like no one can see, but there's lighting for the party and you accidentally turn on the overhead. And it's like, that's not the mood we're going for.
I have been at nightclubs when it's like, lights on, go home.
Fuck, not great. Not a great moment.
Oh. Yeah.